I can see it here. What's up, black community? This is Bro Diallo, of course, broadcasting straight out of the sanctuary hypocrisy that is the city of Chirac, state of Illinois. I'm back on my kryptonite. I'm back on my schedule again. Of course, you know, I'm having trouble. And if I'm moving around because, you know, I'm not trying to be ethereal and stuff, but my wife has this crazy plant that's encroaching. So if you notice me inching over every time I shoot from here, and I've been shooting from the office in the back where I don't have to deal with this, but Wi-Fi, computer, all that stuff has been messing up. And I've been working on it. I've been promising to fix it. But this is where I get the best reception, up here up front. So this is where we're going to shoot until I can figure out and I can go to the office and I don't have to work around these monstrosities, plants and stuff. Because I'm not really trying to be ethereal or, you know, give y'all some type of vibe. But, you know, I prefer a more professional setting. But anyway, until the pandemic is over, this is where we are. We got to work with what we got. You know, we got to start from where we at and work with what we got. So anyway, but I'm very happy to be here because I know I missed last week, grinding, struggling. But y'all ain't here to hear about my struggles. That's not the topic of the show. Because if we're going to talk about my struggles, then that's a whole different session. And I should probably be paying y'all to have to listen to that. Anyway, today is Marcus Garvey Day, of course. Marcus Garvey's birthday. Arguably, debatably, the greatest black leader who, it's undebatable that he led the largest black movement, black liberation struggle of the UNIA that had the largest membership, and even to this day, some of the largest, relatively largest income, resources, and reach of any black organization originating from the Western Hemisphere. I mean, to really match Garvey's impact historically and on black people in this region, in this hemisphere, and worldwide, you'd have to go back to the Haitian Revolution to find another event that is of that magnitude. That many black people, what's weird about Garvey is you find many black people who are very divergent in their views and their beliefs, but they all either claim to admire Garvey, claim to inherit Garvey's legacy, or claim to continue on from Garvey, even though they differ greatly. Everything from Pan-Africanist to black capitalist to black patriots to back to Africa, repatriationist, all claim RBG. Everything, even gangsters now, the revolutionary but gangsters, RBG logo. So you see RBG everywhere. I've even seen some ADOS nonsense with RBG. Moors, the Blackamoors or the Moorish Science Temple, you see them waving the RBG. You see people who embrace the NOI, Nation of Islam, waving the RBG. Some people might say, oh, this is good, this really shows. It does demonstrate Garvey's impact, but to me it's rather, I wouldn't say disrespectful, but it's sad because of the depth of confusion. Everyone lays claim to Garvey, which means Garvey's ideology and agenda has been diluted to where you can find people from Pan-Africanists to black American patriots who all claim to love Garvey, who all claim to inherit Garvey. And the RBG is now the Afro-American flag. Some people say it's the Pan-African flag globally. And some people just, you will even find, if you go up and look, red, black, and green flag, you'll even find the U.S. stars and bars, the U.S. flag, laid out in RBG color code. Or you can even find images of the Confederate flag laid out in RBG color code. So in this initial topic on reflections on Garvey, I think it's tragic that Garvey had a very clear mission, had some very clear ideas. I mean, he wrote out his philosophies and opinions and points of views. And the UNIA had a charter. The UNIA had a mission. UNIA had infrastructures, institutions, and a very clear agenda. And many people who exist in direct opposition or violation of all of that still want to wave the RBG flag. You know, but I digress, because people try to hit me with the head in that too. But so I think we need some clarity on Garvey, because someone, an individual who is so historical and a movement that is so impactful across generations, as I say, I would have to go all the way back to the Haitian Revolution to find another impactful event on the scale of the UNIA. I don't even say the civil rights movement, civil rights reform and legislation come up to that level of achievement of what Garvey did, considering the environment, 1920s, the peak era of Jim Crow and lynching, the era of the high times of European colonialism, the era when the sun never set on the British Empire, going into world, the first industrial war, the environment that he was operating in, as dangerous as it was for Malcolm X and Martin Luther King, as dangerous as it was in terms of white racist aggression, Garvey was operating in an era that was even, I mean, many of Garvey's members were former slaves. They didn't get their humanity and their citizenship until 1869. Until 1869. So anyway, all that to say that Garvey was a phenomenon. When Garvey said, look for me in a whirlwind, it was a very impactful statement, because he was. He emerged seemingly out of nowhere, had a magnificent, if depending on your point of view, if you are a former slave, if you are a freedman, if you were a sharecropper, you know, it was a wonderful. But if you were J. Edgar Hoover, if you were the Western colonial empires, if you were the Jim Crow white folks or Harlem slumlord, he was a horrific manifestation. Even now, if you look at European history and the European point of view, they have documentaries about Garvey. One documentary about Garvey that was put out by PBS about a decade ago talked about how Garvey became a black militant because he sought the affections of a white girl. And my wife talks about this all the time. And because this white girl spurned him, he decided he would take revenge on all white folks. It's kind of like they did the same thing to Nat Turner and even Malcolm X. And so that's one documentary. Another articles that you read, they talk about the top 10 greatest con men of all time. And they say that Garvey's whole Black Star Line steamship company and his Back to Africa movement was a long con. So white folks have continually attacked Garvey. And when they continue to attack you, that means they continue to see you as a threat. So, I mean, Garvey is so pervasive. I don't really even feel that I even have to go into details about specific, like, history. I mean, we all know Garvey. We all know what the red, the black, and the green stand for. We all know about the United Negro Improvement Association, the Black Star Lines, the African Legion, the Black Cross Nurses Association. We all know Harlem, that he gave birth to the Harlem Renaissance. It grew out of his movement. We know a little. I think it's tragic we don't know as much about Carlos Cooks, who took over after him. He was even more hardcore than Garvey, but I digress. I'm saying all that to say is I think it's tragic. I think the true Pan-Africanists, revolutionaries, repatriationists need to reclaim Garvey. I think it needs to be a problem that people can run around talking about revolutionary but gangster when it was gangsters who subverted Garvey, who betrayed Garvey, who set Garvey up. So gangsterism and Garveyism are anathema. Those are two opposing ideologies and mentalities. And I've been going off on this since it became, because I know Dead Prez came out, RBG, Revolutionary But Gangster. I understood what they were doing. I have the album. It's a magnificent album. Get that album if you don't have it, or download it, stream it, whatever the hell y'all do with music nowadays. But it went beyond that album. It became a meme, a motif. And I think that's tragic because I think it's highly disrespectful of Garvey's reality and Garvey's legacy. But another thing I want to talk about, and because I get hit in the head with Garvey all the time too, because I mean, it's well known, I'm an atheist and I'm a socialist. And Garvey, in his first, maybe, I don't know, I'm not going to pretend I have the book memorized, but I would say in the first five pages of the Philosophies and Opinions of Marcus Garvey, he states that he is a Christian and a capitalist. But Marcus Garvey, again, was operating in the 1800s. He was a printmaker. He was actually mentored by Booker T. Washington. So being an industrialist and being a yeoman and an agriculturalist and being a industry, cottage industry individual, that was the capitalism. But he didn't understand capitalism. He didn't have the privilege of living through over a century of capitalist development and capitalist opposition to freedom movements and things like that. But he was a Christian also. But his movement was secular. That's why the man who took over the UNIA, Carlos Cooks, after Garvey was falsely imprisoned and exiled, and they said you can die in prison or you could agree to leave the United States and never return. And so he left the United States, never returned, but he did have a leadership role in the remnants of the UNIA, and even he would come from Europe to Canada, and he would hold court in Canada, and the brothers from New York, Harlem, Detroit, Chicago would go up into Canada across the border to meet with Garvey to give their instructions and stuff. Even the late, great Dr. John Henry Clark was able to meet Garvey. He was a very young man, but he took one of those trips with the UNIA members to meet with Garvey later in his years. And Garvey went on to continue to be an entrepreneur and a capitalist. He even at one time started a traveling carnival circus. So very, very interesting. I think looking, it would do us well to look into Garvey post-UNIA Garvey or post-exile Garvey. We kind of like to cut Garvey off and leave him in that exalted state of the leader and founder of the UNIA, but I think we should also look into how he was taken down, how he responded to the betrayal, and things of that nature. But as I was saying, people like to hit me in the head and say, you claim that you support Garvey, and he was a Christian and a capitalist. And I would say, as far as his Christianity, he was secular in his politics. And the man who took over after him, Carlos Cooks, was an atheist, a professed atheist in the late 1920s, early 1930s, and the UNIA rank and file said, we don't want him to lead us because he's an atheist, and, you know, that's demonic, that's inappropriate. And Garvey expressed his unyielding support for Carlos Cooks, even though Carlos Cooks was a professed atheist and he was an anti-theist. He was very aggressive about not allowing religious leadership or religious dogma to penetrate. And y'all know, even back then, Father Divine, the movement of the gods and earth, Elijah Muhammad, a lot of movements that were religious based, cults were emerging back then. And the UNIA in that time, where everybody was taking a religious slant or falling to religious leadership, the UNIA remained secular in that. In terms of his capitalist, this is pre-investment capital. I think it was a miscalculation. And I would imagine that Garvey, and if you look, Garvey, even being capitalist, he was a cooperative. You know, it was a cooperative. If you look at the formation of how he raised funds, he did it socially and through socialistic and cooperative means. But that's another thing, and that will continue to be debated. I don't agree with either of those. I think that Garvey would have been an even more powerful leader if he had not held so strongly to Christianity and the core beliefs of Christianity. I think they made him vulnerable, and it was part of what made him vulnerable and what made him a relative easy target for subversion. And I like to focus on, because you're going to be hearing a lot, if you're plugged in, if you're in the conscious community, or if it's something that interests you, you're going to be hearing a lot. I even went into it, how great Marcus Garvey is. But what we don't like to do with our leaders, our icons, is really evaluate them critically and focus on what made them vulnerable or where their shortfalls was. But I think how they failed or why someone failed is more important than studying or acknowledging in what they succeeded in. And success that we can be inspired, and their success and their accomplishments can inspire us, but their failings can instruct us. And we need more instruction than inspiration in these times. At least that's my conclusion. You might need more inspiration. I'm as inspired as I want to be, you know, as I ever need. I've got all the inspiration. I am a Pan-Africanist. I am a Black liberationist and revolutionary. So that's where I am until death. So I don't need no more inspiration in terms of fighting for my people and acknowledging the enemies of my people, and the enemies of my people are my enemies until we are liberated. So I think we need information. One thing about Garvey that made Garvey vulnerable is Garvey's misinterpretation of the motivations of white people. If you read Garvey's writings, he would always talk to Black people about us not being on par with the Western powers. He would talk about, where is the Black man's industries? Where is the Black man's military? Where is the Black man's independent nation? Where is the Black man's, and I know man, yep, I mean, it's the 1920s, what do you want? Oh, to this day, we would maybe say person. The Black persons. He'd say, where, in this term, I really like this term, this men of big affairs. Where's the Black man's man of big affairs? He watched politicians and diplomats and generals of European descent go all over the world and negotiate deals, men of industry, He was around in the time of the barons. The great fortunes of the DuPonts and the Rockefellers were being institutionalized and entrenched. You know, this is the time of the Sears Roebuck catalog, and these type of industries were coming and forming, laying the foundations of capitalism, of modern, going from mercantilism to capitalism, or as capitalism as we recognize it today. And he said, but there are no black men engaged in these activities. So Garvey was under the false impression, the fact that he felt that Europeans were unaware of black potential. And he thought that once black people began to demonstrate our capacity to field armies, to construct hospitals, to go home to our original land and make treaties, secure land, build industries, have modern agriculture, modern scientific infrastructure, once we started to embrace our culture and know our true culture, he thought that the Europeans, once they recognized the black man's potential and capacity and willingness to join humanity as a partner, as opposed to being a victim of humanity, that the Europeans would welcome us to the table. And this wasn't a total fantasy for Garvey, because Garvey would see that Europeans at times were forced to the negotiation table. Garvey would see that in places such as Asia, even in the United States in his era, the Native American sovereign nations, the tribal leaderships, would still had treaties that were respected. They still were negotiating with the U.S. government for everything from trade to jurisdiction, whether the tribal law or U.S. Constitution, how they were relate. So Garvey saw all over the world that when the Native American would negotiate with the European as a Native American, not as an American, the Chinese would negotiate, or whether it's a conflict or go to war, conflict or diplomacy. No matter how the interaction was, these people would interact as people with their own identity, self-determination. But the black man in America would engage America as a Negro, as an American. So Garvey said, understood way back then, something Negroes with all the schooling in the world still haven't figured out. Until Africa is of high stature, no man of African descent, no man of the African phenotype will be respected if our motherland isn't respected. So Garvey felt that he just had to show and prove. So Garvey looked at the state of the world and the state of affairs. He looked at how you communication infrastructure, he looked at commercial infrastructure, he looked at resources and raw materials, he looked at shipping, storage, he looked at defense. He looked at basic civil development, civic development, in terms of what services can people provide for themselves within their community. And he started to work on enclaves. He learned a lot from, and as I said, he was coming here to work directly with Booker T. Washington at his institute, but it just that he passed away. Who knows what happened? And in fact, it's kind of funny because Booker T. Washington was an enemy of Du Bois. They were in opposition. And just as he died, as he passed away as the most powerful black man in black America, Marcus Garvey emerged. And Du Bois jumped from fighting tooth and nail with and insulting Booker T to doing the same to Garvey. I mean, Booker T got a lot to answer for. I'm not Booker T. Booker T got a lot to answer for, but Du Bois has a lot to answer for. But some people say they forgive him because his writings are brilliant. He was a brilliant, brilliant black man. So he left us a lot of wisdom, but he got up to a lot of fuckery, bumbleclot fuckery, let's say that in dedication of Garvey's Jamaican roots. But anyway, so he had seen that even though the white man was a terror across the globe, colonizing, raping, extracting resources, planting his flag so that the sun never sets on his empire. If you remember in Black Panther where Killmonger said the sun will never set on the Wakandan Empire, I thought that was disgusting because even though he's a fictional character in a fictional setting, that was a legitimate battle cry for the British imperialist. the sun never sets on the British Empire, meaning that their empire is across the globe. So if right now this I'm in the, on the south side of Chicago in the United States of America, it's late evening here. But on the other side of the world, it's morning. The sun is rising somewhere at all times, and they had so much territory under their flag, under their control, under their domination, that the sun, that it's always daylight on the British Empire. And one of the last prominent imperialists that was fond of saying this was the British bulldog himself, Winston Churchill. So for them to put that on us, for us black folks that aren't historically informed, and they hear about the sun never setting on an empire, and instead of the British, they're thinking about Killmonger and Wakanda. I think that is fucking amazing propaganda. But anyway, Garvey was wrong about that, because Garvey, it seems as though he understood this, but he just didn't internalize it. Europeans knew our potential. They knew our capacity. They knew the history of our civilizations of the past, and they knew our potential for now, because all of their wealth was built by us. All of their industries were constructed by us. All of their resources were extracted by us. All of their infrastructure was built by us. So they knew our potential. So demonstrating, so a European saying, wow, you know, here's a black organization that organized for everything from healthcare to housing to food, and now they went to Liberia and negotiated for rubber, and now they have rubber processing plant, they have their own ships, and they're willing to trade, and they give us fair deals, and when they sign a treaty or negotiate a contract, they stick to that contract and treaty, they're straight dealers. I'm going to get Jim Crow off their backs and allow them to thrive as my brother or as partners, or as independent entities in their own part of the world. They already understood that. So Garvey was trying to demonstrate to our oppressors something our oppressor knew and didn't give a fuck about. And Garvey thought, well, I'm not even going to set up my own independent thing. I'm going to follow. I'm going to make shares in a publicly traded corporations and sell those shares and market them. So Garvey played by their rules. He beat them at their own game, or was beating them at their own game. And they went behind Garvey every single step. They went to Liberia and told them, listen, don't you deal with this nigger from this Jamaican nigger from Harlem. They subverted him every step of the way, and he expected to be able to give the white man a document, and the white man signed his document, and then he expected if there was violation, he could go into the European or the white courts. There was really no World Bank or IMF. There were no international World Trade Organizations. So if you had an issue with an American corporation, you had to take it up. But anyway, he was going to follow their rules and play by their game, even seeing that the game was leveled in their favor. He was like, I'm going to play your game, beat you at your game, and when I demonstrate that I can, I expect to have the same amount of respect. I expect to have the same standing. I expect to be able to navigate the world as you do and engage in commerce, protect the sovereignty of my nations to raise and field armies if need be, but to simply resurrect or reestablish the African nation, African people in their proper station in the world. Nothing more, nothing less. He didn't even have, go read his books, everything with Garvey. I've read every book, everything that Garvey, that I know of, that Garvey wrote, and I read as much as people, what other people wrote about Garvey, as much, from Tony Martin to John Henry Clark. And Garvey's agenda was never to topple the white man, to overthrow the white man, like Malcolm was talking about. To take the devil down, send them and bind them in there, take them back to the Caucasus Mountain and bind the white man. Overthrow, destroy the wicked white man. Armageddon, rain down fire and brimstone on the oppressor. Garvey was like, no, you continue to conduct your affairs within your sovereign boundaries, and I will establish my sovereign boundaries. And that was Garvey's number one flaw, I think, his number one mistake. Aside from the capitalism, Christianity, that was his number one stake. He didn't really understand the motivations, the intentions, and the really depths of hatred. He thought that their hatred was based in their ignorance of what we can do. But really, their hatred is based in their actualization of what they can do. Racism is about insecurity, not supremacy. And Garvey didn't appear to understand that back then, and we don't appear to understand that now. But that's not a slight against Garvey. I mean, if I was born in the late 1800s and came into adulthood in the early 20th century, I mean, I'd probably be, you know, stepping fetching, you know, because I grew up reading Garvey, reading Malcolm. I mean, Garvey didn't have a Garvey to study. Garvey didn't have, was predated Malcolm. Garvey educated Malcolm's father. Malcolm's father was a Garveyite. So, you know, Garvey knew from what he was and the environment he was operating in and coming up on that little island of Jamaica that has produced so much militancy. Shout out to Jamaica and all Jamaicans. And middle finger to ADOS and anybody that's trying to drive wedges between the African diaspora. I don't fault Garvey at all. I don't fault Garvey at all. Garvey didn't have no Google, you know. So, but I think that we don't honor Garvey by ignoring that miscalculation. And I've read Garvey like, man, this plan is solid. To this day, people are trying to read. I mean, Ho Chi Minh took Garvey's agenda to Vietnam. But Ho Chi Minh, because remember, Ho Chi Minh was educated in France. Ho Chi Minh spent a lot of time around Europeans. So Ho Chi Minh is like, they don't oppress us in our country because they don't realize our potential. He understood that. But everything else, look at Ho Chi Minh. When Kwame Ture was the president of the Black Panther Party, or an ambassador, I don't know what it is, if his title changed a few times. But he went with a Black Panther delegation to meet with the Viet Cong guerrillas who were fighting U.S. and French imperialism. And before U.S. and French imperialism, they were fighting Chinese imperialism. They fought everybody who put a toe on their land. Shout out to the Vietnamese. And the first thing, before they even started talking about any potential for solidarity between the Black Panther Party and the Viet Cong, and how they expressed that Black America did not support U.S. aggression or Western aggression, even though we have Social Security cards and U.S. citizenship, we do not align with U.S. foreign policy. Ho Chi Minh said, before all that, let me show you my UNIA membership card. He was so proud of that. And if you read or follow the research of Renoko Roshidi, those are Black people in Vietnam. They Black folks. They're not African. All Black people, all Africans are Black, but not all Black people are Africans. But they are people of color. They have Black phenotypes. But anyway, he took it. Everywhere you look, even if you look at the Irish fight against Western colonialism, and you can see elements of Garveyism, there ain't a movement that emerged since 1925, a movement against Western imperialism that doesn't employ elements of Garveyism. They study us. They study us. You won't believe, I had a cousin who wanted to get her doctorate in anthropology, and she wanted to study white folks and white behavior and white society. And they were like, no, pick some obscure tribe in the third world, some obscure culture, some obscure language or practice, and do your dissertation on that. You can't study white folks. But they study the hell out of us. Volumes and volumes of books about the pygmies and rituals. And half the books I have on the Orisha, on Ifa, are written by white folks. And when I talk to my Nigerian and brothers and people that I know, they're like, yeah, it's accurate. They know their shit because they study us. Anyway, that's my reflection on Garvey. No disrespect to Garvey. No disrespect to the UNIA. As Del Jones says, this is criticism with affection. This is more than criticism with affection. This is critique in utter awe. I'm in awe. But I just want to be the one. Garvey's getting his praise. He's getting his just due. There's two things I want to drive home. Garvey made a few mistakes that if we fixed, we can resurrect Garveyism and bring the whirlwind back. And another thing, we got to let these people who don't truly embody and reflect Garvey's missions. Garvey's mission was the unification of African people, the empowerment and sovereignty of the African continent, and ultimately being have a force for the defense of African people and our resources and our interest. And if any black person talking about RBG, financial literacy, RBG, joining the U.S. military, RBG, going to Harvard and starting a tech startup and becoming a billionaire, all that shit, they are gangster. I'm a gangster, but I drink 40s, but I represent the RBG. It's a pretty simple ideology. It's a pretty straightforward plan. It's beautiful in how thorough yet simple and straightforward it was. So all the RBG pretenders, I ain't saying go out here and start bucking people and stuff, but call them out. Let it be known. Exposure protocol. Isolate. You know, expose, isolate, expel the pretenders. So we should honor the RBG. And we can't let it be pimped, distorted, or diluted. So moving on to the next. I was talking, it's been since Kamala, there was kind of a lull in people talking about the 2020 presidential election. And I was very happy about that because, you know, even though I follow politics, my formal education is in politics and public policy. I've worked on campaigns, everything from a mayoral campaign to school board campaigns. I was kind of happy that there was a lull, just get tight, because it's, I don't mind, I like to discuss politics. I think about it all the time. I mean, I and my politics is different. People get surprised when they hear me. Like, I hear people talk, they're anti-politics. They don't really discuss politics. They are dismissive. They're intellectually lazy. Oh, they're all the same. Voting doesn't matter, things of that nature. So people say a lot of stupid shit about politics, and politics are very important. Bureaucracy is very important. Whether you're trying to integrate into the system or liberate yourself from a system, you better have a thorough understanding of institutions, institutional development, agency capture, bureaucracy, all that shit. You better know it. You can have all the resources in the world, but if you can't establish and properly operate the infrastructure for extraction, processing, or protection of those resources, you're going to be, I mean, we got examples, you're going to be dead broke. You got people everywhere from the Middle East, African continent, all over the world, starving while they stand on top of the greatest pots of wealth, whether it's natural resources or geographical wealth, in the world. So governance is very important. And I see even more, and it makes me happy to see more and more black folks get into anarchy, but I'm not there yet. I don't see the viability of anarchy. I agree with anarcho principles, but anarcho application don't seem real. So I've been doing the Bro Diallo show on Q4 Radio. Shout out to Q4 Radio. I just talked to John. Q4 is still with us, also, the governor of Chicago was in my hood. He wasn't in my hood. You know, he wouldn't come to my hood. I ain't going to diss Prisker. Yes, I am. Who cares? But he was here in the city of Chicago, came up from Springfield to talk about new restrictions. Talk about new restrictions. So anyway, I got some new equipment from my mother-in-law. She gave me a computer, a PC, a Apple PC. And I'm going to try to use that to do remote broadcasting so I can tap into the broadcast system at Q4, and maybe we can get back to the Bro Diallo show broadcasting live from city of Chirac, but also broadcasting across the AM signal, the radio show back from. You come back here again, I'm going to make you come sit on camera. Say, someone keeps roaming around back and forth. It's distracting a bit. But does he care? So if y'all want to see Seikou, y'all want to meet my youngest son. Can't tell my other son anything. He's 18 now. He's grown. So but I can still make the other one do stuff. Anyway, see how? Anyway, so that's that. Shout out to Q4. I talked about, if you go back and look at the Bro Diallo Show archives, if you go to my YouTube, and if you're not a YouTube subscriber yet, why not? What have I ever done to you? I ask so little in return for my efforts. Anyway, I talk about politics every election cycle. Ian and I started a radio program, Zero to 100, if you remember that. And we came in just as Obama was in his lame duck stage. And we were on the air, and I've been on the air throughout the Trump presidency. You know, the Bro Diallo show kind of evolved alongside the Trump presidency. So shout out to scumbag Trump, because he's given me a lot to discuss. He's brought a lot of things to the surface that I've been talking about all my life, and he's proven me right on a lot of things. But let me just say this, and then we'll get into this, and then I'll let y'all go for the evening. I can hear Dr. Mingo, she down there preparing dinner. You notice how if there's some low-level celebrity that got a hit song or trying to creep on a come-up and they have a close relative die, all these people talk about it's an Illuminati blood sacrifice. But when people actually at the tippity top, the actual quote-unquote leader of the free world, he's in a very tight race and he has a close relative die, I ain't seen none of the Illuminati blood sacrifice people. Where the fuck? Y'all some fucking weirdos. Real talk. Like, Jennifer Hudson has a tragedy befall her family. Or they were talking about Aaliyah was Jay-Z's blood sacrifice. I've been hearing this blood sacrifice shit every time somebody with a little bit of name and a little bit of fame has a relative or someone close to them or associated with them die. Here come these crystal copper wearing cats, you know, that talk about, yeah, the Illuminati blood sacrifice. And then they start posting all these pictures of the dude throwing up a peace sign or giving a handshake. And it was Illuminati, and they got all these, and they's like, that was the blood sacrifice. But I was waiting. I gave y'all a couple of days. And I'm like, let me see if one of these crystal copper wearing brothers, one of these El Bays, one of these Illuminati watchers, black in the hood, was going to come up and say that Trump made a blood sacrifice of his brother to regain the presidency. And I didn't see it. Y'all let me down in every way possible. Y'all just boring, mad, corny, man. Fucking corny. So I'm going to be the first to say it. This is the first time that I accept that there's a potential for an Illuminati blood sacrifice. It's Trump sacrificed his brother. So if Trump wins the 2020 election, I'm not voting for him or Biden. I'm voting for Howie Hawkins, green, all the way. We got like six green politicians on the ballot. I will be voting for every green water reclamation. I think we have a green party member running for Congress. So all that being said, real talk, Trump did an Illuminati blood sacrifice of his brother. I suspect. Where are y'all? Where are you blood sacrifice? You got to wait for a B-list celebrity to have a ailing auntie die, and then here y'all come talking shit. Anyway, back to what I should be talking about. Black politics. Hey, here he is. Why did you change clothes again?
I got out of my house.
Come here. Why did you put them on? Were you going somewhere?
Yes.
Come here. You went to Whole Foods?
Yes.
Come here.
What?
I said if you was coming back up here, I was going to make you get on camera. Come here.
Why?
You want me to come get you? You can just come say hi and then go about your business. You've been running back and forth here like 10 times. Say hello. The camera's right there.
What?
You're waiting to see yourself? Just get down here and say
hello.
Hi, this is Seikou.
Hi.
So if I seem distracted.
Hi.
Okay. Can you keep quiet?
I will.
Can you pretend? Anyway, he's probably hating because I beat the crap out of him. And I beat him in Mortal Kombat 11, Gears of War, Age of Empire, everything. I beat him, and he's mad. So he's a hater. Got a little hater in the house. Nah, see, now he'll leave me alone. Sometimes you got to embarrass them. Okay, where were we? Black politics. Sorry. Black politics. He's gone. So. If y'all notice me kind of looking over my shoulders because he was just running back and forth, back and forth. Anyway, I just gave a sober analysis of politics, and someone asked me to expand on the politics things. And I'm going to do a really poor job of expanding on it because I'm running out of time. I don't want to go too long. It's already late. But I don't know how much time I've been on here. 45 minutes. Okay, we're going to keep this under an hour. Black people. Now, this is something I posted, but they wanted me to expand on it. This is pretty much a cogent, sober assessment of black people's politics in the United States as it pertains to not just election 2020 or the POTUS election 2020, but in perpetuity, as long as we're under U.S. democracy, democracy, demonstration of Fela, crazy demonstration, demonstration of crazy. As long as we're under U.S. democracy, demonstration of craziness, this is how we should engage. I support voting, but I'll let the thing suss it out. Here's the first, step by step. When black people engage U.S. politics, we have to be three things. We have to be cold, distant, and calculating. We got to get our emotions out of this, not just our love or fear and anxiety. Never vote out of fear. Oh, I'm so scared Trump will get in. I'm willing to vote for another sexually predatory racist to save me from that. That's how they get you. Don't vote out of fear. Don't vote out of hope and belief that the thing, world's about to change, because you're inevitably going to get played. You're going to get be disappointed and disillusioned. So be cold, distant, and cold. Be on your spot. How do you do that? How does Spock, what's the Spock hand? Oh, here it is. Be on your Spock. When it comes, we need to be Vulcans. I know, I hope Dita is not watching this. He calls me a nerd. But we need to get our Vulcan on when it comes to U.S. Just no emotion. Remove your emotion. Cold, distant, and calculating. When we vote, we need to only vote for three objectives. Those objectives are extraction, harm reduction, and disruption. Now, people said they didn't understand that. Extraction means get what you can get, or as MC8 of Compton's Most, get what you gotta get quick and don't get gaffled in the mix. Get what we can get. If that's housing legislation, if that's food stamps, if that's $1,200 out of the Trump administration, whatever we can extract that could be of benefit to us. Still, 60 to 70% of my DNA is government cheese. If not for that government cheese and that powdered milk, I wouldn't be here talking to y'all. I'd probably have starved to death. If not for Section 8, me, my mama, my younger brother would have died of exposure sleeping in the street somewhere. So if you get your food stamps, get your Section 8, get your Pell Grant, extract whatever you can that could be a benefit of you as an individual, your family, your community, and the larger movement. And you're not extracting. If what you put in is higher than what you get out, that's not an extraction. It's not even a trade. So when I say extraction, I'm not talking about go enlist in the U.S. military for the GI Bill, dummies. Now, I'm not going to call nobody no dummy unless they're a dummy. But if it apply, if I'm throwing a rock into a herd of dogs, a pack of dogs, and the hit dog gonna holler, that's not extraction. Because they get you, you go to advance their empire for a GI Bill and a Dodge Charger. Why do people always associate young vets with Chargers? I don't know. I didn't make it up. I'm just repeating what I heard. That's not extraction. Some of us get confused. We give way more to the government and we get a trickle down. We get a little kickback and we think, yeah, this is extraction. No. So if you had to join the military and put your life online for the empire, then you haven't extracted. That's a net loss. So extraction means we give less of an input, we extract more than we put in. And I know some racists are going to see this because for some reason, racist people pop up. Karens and Joshes and Chads pop up in my stuff. Yes, well, black people are always taking more than we get from the government. That's not true. And in fact, black people would have to exclusively extract from this government for 300 years, 100% of all the wealth of the government, and give nothing in order for us to break even. So what I'm saying is now, that should be what we vote for. So universal health care, that don't mean if you, we're going to have the black liberation struggle. It's not an option. Do you want to fight and struggle for universal health, for black liberation with universal health care or with for-profit health care? Do you want lead in your water or do you want proper water filtration? So I'm not saying any of this stuff is an alternative to struggle. It simply is a supplement or lateral to struggle. So that's what extraction means. Getting more for our inputs than we put in. So if I'm gonna go vote, that's a few minutes out of my day. But I'm gonna vote for universal health care. I'm gonna vote for ecological policies, the party and the politicians that promise ecology. I'm gonna vote for the party and politicians that will prioritize development of the infrastructure of my community over more war funding. I'm gonna vote for the politicians that are anti-drone. I'm going to vote for the politicians that support enforcement and adherence to international law and treaties, so that the U.S. can't go and violate the sovereignty of other nations. So I'm going to vote to things that are a benefit, even if I'm not going to be so short-sighted and say, who does it put money in my personal pocket? If it helps our brothers and sisters in Somalia, I would vote for the politician that will promise to defund and demobilize AFRICOM. That is a benefit to Ghana. And what benefits Ghana and benefits Haiti and benefits brothers in Oakland? My brother's over there. What if I can cast a vote that will lean or push towards that way? And one thing, Obama was a very dishonest politician, but one thing he did say is that government is like a super tanker. It takes a lot to turn. But you got to start that turn. You got to start to push it. You got to plan. If you're driving a super tanker or an aircraft carrier, if you plan on making a right turn, you got to plan hours in advance for that turn. So if you're looking towards a political agenda, sometimes you got to plan sometimes a generation ahead for political outcomes. It was brothers and sisters fighting for things in the civil rights movement that they knew they wouldn't live long enough to take advantage of. They were fighting for their descendants. Sometimes you got to do that in a vote. So it's extraction. Harm reduction is basically you're going to try to look for the outcome that does the least damage. Sometimes when you're voting, James Baldwin says sometimes when black people go to the polls, all they're voting for is extra time. Because you're not about to get anything from either party, but the party that will give you time. So sometimes when you go to the polls, you have to think to yourself, who would be more vulnerable to us? If I want to vote and I go to vote in the U.S. election, which administration do I think would be easiest for us to confront and fight against, or easiest for us to work around or under or to subvert? You ask those questions. They're very calculating. And don't just say what you believe or feel. Do your research. You know, with a first term Biden or a second term Trump, because they're both against us. And if I got to run down to you all the harm that Biden has done to black people, not just while he was VP under, but his entire senatorial and political life, then you just crawl back under your rock, go back to sleep. But you have to say, who's more vulnerable? Now, it goes without saying, the Democratic Party is more malleable to the black electorate than the Republicans. But also, even though the Democratic Party is more malleable, more moldable and movable by our community, they also, the phenomenon of lulling back people back into a false sense of security and comfort. So even though we have the greatest amount of potential to politically influence the Democratic Party, we tend to waste that potential. We tend to demobilize and be more apolitical under Democratic. So that's the problem. If you think, well, if you could say, well, we have more, and these are this is all supported by stats. I'm not talking about what I believe or how I feel. And it's hard to talk politics because most people, when they talk politics, they're not cold, distant, and calculated. But moving on, but harm reduction is saying, you know, both of the politicians suck, but which politician is less likely to destroy the Gulf of Mexico? I would have thought voting against Obama versus John McCain, if I wanted to do a harm reduction vote, I'd vote for Obama because Obama said that he acknowledged climate change and that he would take steps to reduce U.S. carbon emissions. A bold-faced fucking lie. But I didn't know. It was his first term. He was a relative political newbie. But if you would say, well, if Obama was elected versus McCain, which one of these two politicians were more likely to destroy the ecosystem of the Gulf of Mexico? I'm like, well, I'll vote for Obama if it's for nothing more than to save the Gulf of Mexico. But George W. Bush did more for environmental and ecosystem